Good evening, fellow Orovilleans, friends. Today we have a subject which I find very important. Of course, all the subjects which I comment upon, I find important. Being human and the Copernican principle. This must be a little mysterious. I must say, I like to make mysterious titles, like Adam Katman and the evolution. You know, people now are saying chameleon and the evolution. Something mysterious but meaningful, I hope. At the time that I have been here in the ashram and in Oroville, I think that what was most lacking and what has led to most of the uneasy situations nowadays, the friction and so on, is the lack of knowledge. Now, I know very well that everybody has his approach in the yoga towards his own development. But we are supposed to be into integral yoga, where we are beginners, because integral is total, and it comprises the yoga of the heart, bhakti, it comprises the yoga of the works, like giving talks, for instance, karma, and it comprises also the yoga of knowledge. To be an integral yogi or yogini, one has to develop and acquire the three. So anybody who says, yeah, but I prefer the yoga of love, and or I prefer the yoga of works without thinking about the rest, they are right, but it is a beginning. And I like to say about myself, and I mean that it is a basis to stand on, I am an absolute beginner. We are beginners in this great thing that is now working in the world, this force that is working in the world, and of which our destiny is a part, this life and the coming lives, and surely some of the past lives, long before it had these names of integral yoga and that names of the supermind and so on were known and were there to be lived, to be realized. In the integral knowledge, science has a very important part, and it is very often misunderstood. It has such an important part because it is an important something in the world. This is a world of technology and science so general that you cannot go around it. Even here in Oroville, the construction of the Matrimandir and whatever it may be has to do and to see with science. This is an integral yoga of which the world of science is a part. So what is there then necessary is an interface, a meeting of science and spirituality. And this usually is a disaster, because science makes fun of mysticism and anything that has to see with occultism and with imagination and with hallucination. You know, you see in the Thoughts and Aphorisms, the very first aphorism that Sri Aurobindo wrote there was, one of the very first was about hallucination. They say what I am living is hallucination, but for me it is totally real. And when the divine embraces me, then who am I to say that this is a hallucination? But science always has proofs. It can prove what it says with formulas and with technological things that it makes. The facts are there, the formulas are there, the proofs are there. While in spirituality, people who have to make that interface with science never have the arguments. They always lose. They should know better, because it is not necessary to lose. You can really go against and with science in all the arguments, and one of the great books, volumes of arguments against science, is The Life Divine, when it is read in the proper way. Then, of course, people always forget that there are so many sciences, many of which approach very closely the mysticism and so on of spirituality. When one speaks about science, one thinks about atoms and the cosmos and so on. One thinks fundamentally about physics. Physics is the norm of science. But biology is far from physics. The archaeologists and the paleontologists who are there scraping the ribs of a dinosaur somewhere in Argentina or in Pakistan are not doing these formulas, the astounding formulas, like, for instance, the E equals MC squared and so on. This is very different. The surgeon who is operating, then the people who are staring in the telescopes at the cosmos are doing quite different kinds of science than what physics normally represents. There are many sciences, many of which are on the border between imagination and supposition and guess, as well as they are in spirituality. To know about science, one doesn't have to know the formulas. And that is quite often misunderstood. One can just study the conclusions of the scientists who have made the formulas. I cannot do the formulas. I am not a mathematician. I have learned some elementary mathematics, but between that and quantum mechanics or string theory is a very big difference. But they write, the great scientists themselves have to make the conclusions which they get from their formulas. And one formula or a set of formulas can lead to very different conclusions with different scientists. So I read their books. We can read their books, and that is why they write the books and make quite a handsome fortune of writing such books about their conclusions. For instance, A Brief History of Time was one of the best sellers for months and months and months. The book by Stephen Hawking, that very strange scientist, which is considered to be a kind of pope of science. To study science, one has to know science, one has to study many years. Once Carl Sagan has calculated, he says, to come at the doorstep of what I have become as a scientist, I had to study 15 years. This is quite respectable. But all these same scientists are talking about religion, spirituality, psychology, history, and all the rest without having studied anything, relying only on what they have known in their education, in the course of their education. And because they know the physics, or whatever the biology, whatever it be, because they are great scientists in that branch of science, they are supposed to be able to speak out about all the rest. And they are creating an atmosphere at the moment which is really very dangerous. And I have thought about that, to use the word dangerous, because here, where we are, the atmosphere is a little different. We are in a special place. But if you look in what is happening in the world, in what is being published in the world, then you see that the mentality has been created, not is being created, has been created, that makes it so difficult for all kinds of other approaches, non-scientific approaches, to come to the surface and to be talked about. If you are a student in medicine, you cannot talk about homeopathy, about Ayurveda and all the rest. You will be immediately elbowed out by your colleague. If you are studying at Princeton or at the Massachusetts Institute of Technology or wherever, any university, any branch where physics is studied, and you come with something a little not usual, you will be elbowed out. Just see what has been happening to Rupert Sheldrake and even to David Bohm and to so many others. So the atmosphere has been created of not accepting what is not materialistic. And that is, of course, what is living in every human. So there is a kind of culture, scientific culture, which has gone through the world, conquered the world, and in the West creates what is a scientific atmosphere, and in Eastern countries creates a split in the thinking. Because there, the tradition is still so powerful that students, boys and girls who go to scientific institutions have to choose how they will talk. Will they talk about the science when they are among with their professors? Will they follow the tradition when they are with their family? And in themselves, this creates a split which is very important in India, in Thailand, in Japan, and in China, and everywhere. There is a split created by this evolution, created by science. Now, this is not to speak denigratingly about science, because then I would not be following what is most dear to me, that is Sri Aurobindo and the mother's opinion. Sri Aurobindo has written, it is well that we should recognize the enormous, the indispensable utility of the very brief period of rationalistic materialism through which humanity has been passing. For that vast field of evidence and experience, which now begins to reopen its gates to us, can only be safely entered. That vast field of experience, he means the spiritual field of experience, can only be safely entered when the intellect has been severely trained to a clear austerity. And how often have they not said, when you dive into experiences or you think you have had this and that and all that, that elevates you from the ground on which we are standing, how often the mother and Sri Aurobindo has said, what is important is a clear mentality to judge your own experiences, to judge what is going on around you, and to evolve. It is only when you have that you can develop the inner life which leads beyond it. Sri Aurobindo also wrote, the scientist is man the thinker mastering the forces of material nature by knowing them. Life and matter are, after all, our standing ground. He has begun the Life Divine with a similar statement. Life and matter are our standing ground, our lower basis, and to know their processes and their own proper possibilities and the opportunities they give to the human being is part of the knowledge necessary for transcending them. He also wrote, three things will remain from the labor of the secularist centuries. Number one, the truth of the physical world and its importance. Number two, the scientific method of knowledge, especially the experimentation. Number three, and last, though very far from least, the truth and importance of the earth, life, and the human endeavor, its evolutionary meaning. Of course, the evolutionary vision is the backbone of his own view, of his own philosophy. Science as such is a search for truth. And the mother has often talked about it in the entretien and in the agenda. She has often said they are looking for the truth and inevitably they must come out at the same point because there is only one truth. By the end of her life, she has changed this opinion because she saw that science had hardened into a dogmatic church. And then she has said it may not be, science has to be bypassed or surpassed or broken up for humanity to go farther. That kind of science is scientism. So you have science, the looking for the truth, for the facts, and this whole science movement had to evolve against, on the matter of life or death, against the Christian Catholic imposition of dogmatic truths. The cosmos is like that, the creation is like that, God is like that, the facts are like that, the human being is like that, the soul is like that, heaven and hell are like that. Against this imposition, which was a matter of life or death, so many have been burned, tortured, or killed in other ways because they were not orthodox following the dogmas. Against this, the whole scientific movement during the Renaissance and during the Enlightenment has to come up. And people have dedicated their lives for that. And people have been searching, they have been quarreling, they have also worked together. They have gone against this whole mentality, risking their life to say, this is the truth. And I know that it is the truth because I do this experiment, I see what it is, I describe it. Please, you repeat it and see whether what I find is true or not. So you see, science is very respectable. Is really worth our appreciation then as it is today. But scientism is another matter. Scientism is based on the following principles. Which were, what shall I say, purified, found by Galilei and the people around him at that time, then by Kepler, then by Newton, the following principles. Number one, science should be about matter. Because according to dogmatic scientists, there is only matter and nothing else. And this is such an elementary truth that you will not find it in the books anymore. You have piles and piles of textbooks and vulgarizing books, popularizing books, piles and piles where it is not even mentioned that everything is about matter and can only be about matter, number one. Number two, science has no grasp on wholes, but has to reduce all things to parts consisting of smaller parts, consisting of still smaller parts, it is reductionist. And why is it like that? And why can it not be otherwise than that? Because it is a matter of the mind. And the mind can only define, take out parts of the whole. The mind cannot be holistic because it doesn't know everything. It can only approach parts, it can only define parts, it can only take on parts, otherwise it has no grasp. This, my dear friends, is so important that I would like for myself to go deeper in this matter of what is the mind, what is the mental consciousness. It is the key of all philosophy, old and new. It is the key of Buddhism, it is the key of Aristotelianism, it is the key of Heidegger and Sartre and Nietzsche. Because what is the mind? That strange thing that nobody sees and that determines everything, with which we think, with which we speak, with which I am speaking at the moment. So science is a mental something that only can define and grasp parts. It is reductionist. And that is one of its limitations. It is leading down everything to elements. And the whole escapes because the unity is not its domain. Number three, all changes in matter are brought about by external forces. This excludes any kind of internal movement or life. Forces, like billiard balls. I would like to give forces touching the microphone from outside. Inside, life, condemned, anathema. Vitalism, anathema. Everything that comes from inside, the soul, the ensoulment, the movement, this is not science. Science is about a matter of external forces. Number four, science can only work with the primary qualities of things, extension, motion, and mass. Secondary qualities like color, scent, or taste are effects of the primary qualities. This means that in fact, science is reasoning in a black and white world. And black and white should not even be there because they have to do with color. It should be positive, negative world, abstract. All the rest, what we are actually seeing, what we are smelling, what we are feeling, secondary qualities which have to be found their explanation and origin in the primary extension, motion, mass. Number five, the language of science is mathematics, based on measurement. Yes, and it cannot be anything other than mathematics because science is about matter. And mathematics can only be applied to matter. And they have tried, there have been movements in modern science that try to measure the life expressions of animals and of human beings, and every time it has been a misadventure. And number six, in science, all guesses, theses, or theories have to be tested as to their truth and reality, the crucial role of the experiment. And that fundamentally is what science is about. And that was the pride of these first people, these scientists, these amateurs, mostly rich amateurs, and many other pastors or vicars in England who had the time to practice science. You know, these were all mostly amateurs who were experimenting. The experiment was the test and the crux of everything of their thinking. Because otherwise, it was dictated. Can you imagine that during the late Middle Ages, when they were starting to operate and to give demonstrations in universities of the human anatomy and all that, the surgeon was a kind of minor personality, while the professor had the books of Galien and other classical doctors and read from them, while the other was carving in dogs and even in humans. In humans not alive, but in dogs well alive without any anesthetics. It was a bloody mess at that time, which I will not describe or try to describe. But they were reading while the barber surgeon was carving. So you see, these principles are the principles of science, and they are so important, and they are very seldom realized. And then in the whole of history, slowly it has developed more and more, but the principles remain the same. And now we have come at a time of the split brain, where people, whether they be Anglicans or they will be Seventh-day Adventists or whatever, they can be science, but they have to live with a split brain. One side of the brain believes, the other side is scientific. Now we are in the age of confusion, postmodernism. The age where no longer there is any truth to be professed, to be recognized as such. There are no fundamental truths anymore. There are no fundamental explanations. Everything is a happenstance evolution of something that has started and that is going on. Even in science, before they were looking for something, a truth. Now, since Thomas Kuhn, it is realized that in fact they are reasoning according to fashions, paradigms. And when enough people accept this, there is something growing, an atmosphere which accepts it and in which you can be accepted if you are introduced and recognize what they recognize. And then after some time there are facts, so many, which contradict this, that a new paradigm has to be made with many difficulties and with many clashes between the old and the new and so on and so on. It is fundamentally the whole of life, the whole of the world and the whole of humanity is a matter of contingency and of chance. In the West, what is carrying at the moment the world mostly, and immediately I will say there are so many nice people and there are so many nice things, but mostly is excitement, fun, sex at the moment, a kind of a dance against the wall of uncertainty of tomorrow. About that we have already talked in our 2012 and 1956. In the East, as I say, tradition is still there. At the moment, my partner is at the marriage in Bhubaneswar. Nothing more traditional than that. With expenses and all, the whole family comes together and has to be entertained and has to be done. The tradition is living on. Of course, there is also the religious tradition and partly the spiritual tradition. But on the other side, there is the Coca-Cola culture. This is my term. You can make any, find any term you want. It is the Western Nike Reebok culture. And that is what all the young ones want. Put on any channel of the TV and you will find the reflection of this. So on the one side, there is the age-old tradition. On the other side, there is a modern culture, which is what is fashionable, what is desirable, what is talked about them and what they want. This is another division with which the Eastern countries will have to reckon. Because whatever they say, the India has that treasure from the thousands of years ago, where they have discovered through inner discovery the Vedantic truths. But India also has the great problems of having this growth of population and all these youth, these millions and millions and millions, wanting what? Is the past still of any significance for them? Or is it the other kind of culture in which they hope to have a kind of joyful, fun, excitement, sex world on earth? It is such a problem that I have already often thought of writing a kind of symbolical letter to a student, a girl or a boy, in Delhi or in Mumbai or in Calcutta or in Chennai, and saying, what is for you valuable? Second point, a great question for the European Union movement. How can you apply to this kind of world in confusion the values of Sri Aurobindo and the mother without making a religion of them? And that is not easy to answer. We should talk about, I should talk about the Copernican principle. You know, Copernicus has calculated, and by his calculations proved, that the Earth is no longer, is not the center of the universe, that it is the Sun, and that the Earth, like the other planets, turns around it. That is the Copernican discovery. What is the Copernican principle? The Copernican principle says that everything is alike from the standpoint of the Sun. The Earth is no longer special, so the human is no longer special. The human is no longer the king of creation. That is the Copernican principle. They also call it the principle of mediocrity, which actually would better have been called principle of average. All are alike. The worm in the garden, and the bird in the sky, and the woman on the bicycle, and the child in the cradle. All are the creations of chance and evolution. The principle of mediocrity, the Copernican principle. One scientist has formulated it as follows: our tenacious illusion of special dispensation belies our true status as upright mammalian weeds. We are in an illusion that we are special, special dispensation. In fact, we are living things, weeds, mammalian, because we belong to that class of the mammals. That is our true status. Among all the rest of the animals and the plants and everything that has grown on earth. In The New Scientist of 20th December 2008, they have a banner. Who did most to knock man off his pedestal? Who has done most to put man a peg or two lower? Was it Galilei or was it Darwin? Galilei and Copernicus have removed us from the center of the universe. Darwin has placed man among the animals, and he has struck at the root of what it means to be human. This problem is far from solved. There are still so many books written at the moment, militant books, about what man has become, what man actually is. So you know, Copernicus in 1543 published his book. Actually, his book was published. He was dying at the moment, it seems. The Revolutionibus Orbium Celestium. And he was still, and that is not often realized, completely tied to the idea of the circle. This is such a lesson for us to see how we can be tied and stick to some mental images and mental ideas without even being aware of it. What was this idea, this ideal of the circle? Well, according to the old Greeks, ancient Greeks, the circle was the symbol of perfection. As everything in the cosmos was created by God or the gods, everything has to be perfect, everything had to move in circles. Copernicus still believed that, Galileo still believed that, Galileo still believed that. It was only Kepler, that genius, that mystic, Johann Kepler, who for the first time saw, calculated that it was not all circles. Because of these circles, they had to find other circles and others to explain that not circular movement. And it was only he who has then mathematically proven that. So since Copernicus, Galilei, it is now fashionable to say the Earth is only a speck, a small planet around a very ordinary sun in a very ordinary galaxy somewhere in a corner of the universe. Bertrand Russell, as an example, said, for instance, the Earth is one of the smaller planets of a not particularly important star, a very minor portion of the Milky Way, which is one of a very large number of galaxies. And altogether, the idea that we who crawl about on this little planet are really the center of the universe is one which I don't think would occur to anybody except us. So pretentious is the human being to think that it is special on this little planet. Now, of course, Russell does not mention that, first of all, there have to be beings on other planets to have other ideas and to be more humble than we were. Then there is the Darwinian standpoint who has brought man down psychologically more than biologically because he still had no proof. First there was Linnaeus, Christian, but he had already classified man among the primates. But he had not commented upon it. He was very prudent. And this happened in 1750, 100 years before Darwin came with his Origin of Species. But even in the Origin of Species, Darwin did not touch on the human being. He showed that everything was a matter of evolution. He thought he showed that everything was a matter of evolution. But he didn't talk about man. First of all, his wife was extremely great believer and he did not want to shock her, as you may see in the films on his life and so on. And the second point is that he himself was still not very sure, because all the documentation and all the fossils and all the paleontological proof we have now was not existent at that time. Darwin did not write about the human, that the human descended from the monkey. Darwin did not write that, although everybody thinks that he did. He did it only 23 years later in his Descent of Man. But everybody has drawn the right conclusion immediately. And then, of course, this was so shocking. For instance, Claude Allègre, a great French scientist, says, how could one agree? How could one accept that among the forefathers of Christ there was a monkey? This is the question very bluntly put. That among our forefathers, so also about the forefathers of Christ and his mother Mary and his father Joseph, there were monkeys. It's an elementary, childish way of reasoning, but it is the gut's reaction which immediately came up and made, of course, all the headlines of those days. Now, this problem is still there. Because in the West, there is no knowledge. And this is a very strong statement, but I could repeat it in full consciousness. There is no knowledge. There are bribes of former religions, especially Christianity. There are suppositions, there are philosophies of rational traditions, starting with the Greeks. But you read all the philosophers of today and you will see only confusion. There is no knowledge. What is awaiting is that knowledge here, if rightly understood, is able to meet and to penetrate and to enliven the knowledge and the seeking there. Because, if I may repeat so, I am not speaking with any denigration of the West or of science or whatever. All these people have their lives. They are intelligent. They were as intelligent 5,000 years ago as we are. They were always as intelligent now everywhere. They have a heart and they have a soul. And in the great writers, you find always these approaches of just there where in the India, especially in India and in most of the East, the people have gone inside, taken the time, dedicated their lives to the discovery of what is actually the ground of things. There is knowledge, but it cannot be taken up as a mental knowledge. You can read the whole of Sri Aurobindo and all the works of the mother, and I had to go several times to it. It is such a pile of books. You can go through all that without being somebody else, without being something more, without having evolved. What counts is what you do with it. What counts is your inner discovery. So that is the knowledge which is brought. And this knowledge is, of course, extremely valuable. If you have a map, where to go is already something, and then you have to go the way, the path on yourself. That is the situation we are in at the moment. So there you have among the scientists of the moment, of the followers of Darwin, like for instance Stephen Jay Gould, which is, you will find his books in Landmark and in all the bookshops of the world still. He died some time ago. He was a great writer and he was a paleontologist at Harvard University. And for him it's quite simple. The existence of the human being, like all the rest in the world, is a matter of contingency, of chance. If Picaia had not survived, we would not have been here. What is Picaia? Picaia was a kind of a worm like that, but everything at that time was still in the water, swimming there, and it may have been the first vertebrate. The first one which had a backbone. So all the rest, including ourselves, come from them. If that Picaia had not existed, we would not have been here. This, of course, is again one of these reasonings which are nothing more than demagoguery. Because if Pikaya had not been there, we would not have been there. But if the monkey had not been there, we would not have been there. And if the amphibians would not have been there, we would not have been there. If the cell had not been formed and procreated, we would not have been there. You see, he has the art of writing in such ways that people say, yes, true, of course, without thinking twice that what he says, if everything had not evolved according to a pattern of chance, we would not have been there. In other words, we are just lucky to be there if we find that it is worth to be called lucky. And he says also, Stephen Jay Gould, we are here because an odd group of fishes had a peculiar fin anatomy that could transform into legs. Four legs for terrestrial creatures, because the earth never froze entirely during an ice age. And there he is wrong, because in the meantime they have discovered that the earth has frozen over two times completely, which is called in science snowball earth. We are here because a small and tenuous species, Homo sapiens, arising in Africa a quarter of a million years ago, has managed so far to survive by hook and by crook. We may yearn for a higher answer, but none exists. And there the matter rests. We are here by accident. Copernicus, Darwin, the Darwinist. And there is a third term that shows how accidental we are. And that third element is the second law of thermodynamics. And thermodynamics is the matter of atoms, molecules, expanding when they are becoming hotter, contracting when they are becoming colder. The masses, the volumes of atoms, of molecules. The first law of thermodynamics is the law of conservation of energy. All energy remains the same within stable volumes. When nothing has access to that, all energy remains the same. The second law of entropy is the law of increase of entropy or molecular disorder. Haha, it is not as complicated as it sounds. There is a law that if you have a volume of a gas or a volume of molecules, necessarily the disorder will grow, the degradation will grow. Order is formation, disorder is degradation. So everywhere in the universe, as the universe is supposed to be one volume, this disorder can only increase, can only grow. And then a scientist has said, the long-term future is bleak. Entropy will continue to increase. The universe will continue to degrade. Every physical process in the universe follows the second law of thermodynamics. We face a continuous downward spiral of no return. And then, I don't know why, all at once he falls into Italian. Coraggio domani sarà peggio. Courage, tomorrow will be worse. Sagan has said, the secrets of evolution are time and death, disintegration. And the mother has said, materialism is the gospel of death. And then you read all these books, you know. The earth is dying. The sun is dying. The Milky Way is dying. The universe is dying. And you find these articles in the Scientific American. At that time, billions of years into the future, everything will be dark. All the stars will be dead. No light anymore. Billions of years in the future. Indeed, life is about half over. Life is about half over. Our estimates are that the first living organisms appeared on Earth in the order of 3 to 4 billion years ago. And we know from stellar evolution that our sun will expand and burn up the Earth. The sun will burn up the Earth in another 3 to 4 billion years, putting an end to everything. So it will finish in 3 to 4 billion years. What are we talking about? Man exists since 2 million years. Homo ergaster, not even Homo sapiens. Life exists since 4 billion years. The first cells. And what is going to happen in the future? Well, at least they should learn the lesson from history that it is always the unforeseen that is happening. So, they will sing hymns to the creative force that has made animal into this, into that, into man, singing hymns on it. But all at once they fall into a completely black picture where everything is there. In 4 billion years, we will not be there anymore. This is what they are suggesting. I will not be there anymore in many less years than that. I am almost 76 at the moment. In 4 billion years, what is going to happen? If all these wonders about which they are making the magnificently illustrated books, all these wonders, how wonderful science is who has discovered all that in biology and all that. If all these wonders were possible in the past, why would there not be wonders in the future? And of course, here we have the assurance of the greatest wonder, as Sri Aurobindo and the Mother have told us. So what is going to happen with the Earth? Remember that the Mother said, La terre, on ne la détruit. One does not destroy the Earth. So what is going to happen, it is wonder after wonder. And now, of course, we are, as I have been talking about before, in a crisis, which for everybody makes tomorrow look questionable. Even maybe improbable, we are among the only ones, if not the only ones, who have an assurance that tomorrow will come, that we have to go through this because we are changing from one situation, from one paradigm into a next one, which will be a greater kind of existence without suffering, without death, without all the problems we have today. Of course, science like this falls in total absurdity. Steven Weinberg, Nobel Prize winner, said, I sort of enjoy my tragic view. He is an atheist, of course. I think the tragic view adds a certain dimension to life. Anyway, it's the best we have. And then you have Stephen Hawking, who I have already mentioned at the very beginning. This is the scientist, a kind of a genius, who has this incredible illness because of which he can only move 2 fingers of one hand to do manipulate a little his computer. He has a very special computer. And Stephen Hawking is considered by many in the press and by the public as a kind of a genius, that an oracle who says what, where science is, what it is about, and what it has to tell us. And he was the man who wrote A Brief History of Time, which ended with the following words: if we discover a complete theory, it would be the ultimate triumph of reason. A complete theory is a theory that in one set of equations determines the whole of existence. Only in matter. It would be the ultimate triumph of reason, for then we should know the mind of God. Now here, Mr. Hawking, the mind of God is not a supermind as you suppose. It is not a mind that works as yours and mine and the normal human mind. The mind of God is not a mind which you would call like that. The mind of God is a mind that sees in one time and that is at the same time. Now, Hawking, together with a Russian scientist, has published a new book quite recently called The Grand Design. And when that book was published, the Times of London bannered Hawking: God did not create the universe. We know, because of Hawking, God did not create the universe. Then how has the universe come about? The universe arose from nothing, says the book, courtesy of the force of gravity. And the laws of nature are an accident of the particular slice of universe we happen to inhabit. God may exist, Hawking told Larry King on CNN, but science can explain the universe without the need of a creator. Now, first of all, from nothing can come nothing. And Sri Aurobindo has insisted on that several times in his writings. Normally, when people hear in science and say nothing, they have something in their head which is not nothing, but something. Courtesy the force of gravity. Where was that force of gravity in nothing? That force of gravity, as everything is being and filled, must be something. Then he talks about a particular slice of universe we happen to inhabit. And that is completely new, since the string theory and the membrane, the M theory and all that, now it is allowed to think that there may be many, many, many universes. Before, this was hallucination. Now it is allowed to think like that, you know, and in all these universes have their set of laws. So then in one of these universes, this has happened by the force of gravity out of nothing, that universe came there. God may exist, but science can explain the universe without the need of a creator. And that, of course, is the crux of the problem, the creator. He, Hawking, just like all the Western scientists, can only think within the frame of a creator, a God outside of his creation. Jehovah, the Judeo-Christian God, or whatever it may be. And this is then what the message, what the East has to bring. God is not something that has made something outside of himself. He is that. And we will have occasion to talk about it when we talk about the theodicy. God does not exist outside of his creation. He is his creation. There is no room outside God, as defined as Brahman, for something else, but then there would be two Brahmans, which would be against the definition, and it seems against the experience. So you see, because of this Copernican principle, because of Galileo, Copernicus, and then the second law of thermodynamics, and Darwin, and the whole biology now very militantly defending its atheism, with people like Dawkins and like Gould, you have this church of science, which is not science purely, it is scientism, it is dogmatism. And that is the danger, and that is spoiling so much, which has to be reconquered by the spirituality of the future. Paul Davies is a very well-known author. He has now written something like 20 books. He's a scientist, a real scientist, not only a popularizer. And in one of his last books, he concludes, "There is a sizable group of scientists who wish to diminish or even besmirch human significance. There is a sizable group of scientists who wish to diminish or even besmirch human significance, and with it the significance of human qualities such as intelligence and understanding. For these scientists, any suggestion of a theological trend or progressive evolution towards consciousness or even towards greater complexity is anathema, because they are not reasoning in terms of consciousness. Their arguments, however, also carry barely concealed overtones of an ideological agenda." They have their ideological agenda of scientism. "In this respect, they are little different from those who have decided in advance on this or that religious interpretation of nature. They are just doing like all the religions and have their own religious interpretation. And then they shoehorn the scientific facts to fit their preconceived beliefs. They procrastinate, they cut the facts to side to fit into their dogma. Meanwhile, it has to be admitted, most scientists stick with something like the absurd universe and get on with their work, leaving the big questions to philosophers and priests." Now, I have two notes in the margin. According to the general understanding, the Earth, according to Copernicus, was taken out of the center and the Sun became the center. But before Copernicus, was the Earth the center of the universe? Everybody who has read about that, who has read a little about it, will say, yes, of course. And it was not. What was the center of the universe? Hell. And where is hell? Hell is below our feet, according to that times, those times. Heaven is up, hell is below. Hell was at the center of the earth. The center of the universe was hell. It was not the earth. And here is something quite amusing, I think. Galileo became a well-known mathematician because of a small book he had written, La Bilancetta. The academic establishment welcomed him with open arms and asked him to apply his mathematical ability to what was to them a far more important problem, the calculation of the exact location and dimensions of hell. The academicians, eh, at that time. Because they were living in that world. The exact location and dimensions of hell as described in Dante's Inferno. Galileo took this assigned task seriously. Over the course of 2 lectures to the Florentine Academy, he used mathematical arguments to demonstrate that hell must have the shape like a cone, with a point at the center of the earth and the circular boundary of the surface passing through Jerusalem. His argument convinced the aristocratic audience. They agreed with him. And he was rewarded with a lectureship in mathematics at the University of Pisa, where he soon realized that he had got the mathematics of hell badly wrong. So you see, history is always amazing if one goes into the details. Not in the known stories, in the reported stories, in that, but when you go into the reality and in the details of the reality, you discover such amazing things. The second notation in the margin is, as I have tried to explain at a former time, Earth is special. Earth is not a planet among other planets, and now, of course, the exoplanets, the planets outside the solar system, are being discovered by the dozen. They are in the center of the attention and of all the writings about science in the whole world. So you may remember that I said another time how the mother insisted on the fact that the Earth is special. In the immensity of the astronomical skies, Earth is a thing absolutely without interest and without importance. But from the occult and spiritual point of view, Earth is the concentrated symbol of the universe. For the convenience and necessity of the work with a capital letter, the whole universe has been concentrated and condensed symbolically in a grain of sand, which is called the Earth. And therefore, it is the symbol of all that is to be changed, all that is to be transformed, all that is to be converted is there, is here. This means that if one concentrates on this work and does it, all the rest will follow automatically if one does it here on earth. La terre, on ne la détruit pas. One does not destroy the earth, neither in millions or billions, or maybe by that time something has happened that the physical earth may not be of any importance anymore. So the title of my talk was Human Being and the Copernican Principle. The human being, according to the tradition, is made in the image of God. When one sees that in the biblical way of the story, God, like a potter, has made man from clay and blown life into him, and there you had Adam. But when you see it in the way in which I have to try to explain in my very first talk, Adam Katman and the evolution, then you have this archetype of the superhuman being that is the cause of the formation throughout evolution, throughout the evolution towards how we look, how everything has always been supposed to look, with a head and a body and the arms and legs, but something behind that in matter still is in on the way of realization. We are halfway. We are still in gross matter. But this matter is already so different from the matter of the chimpanzees. And that is the reason that now they will say, you know, the chimpanzees have 98.5% of all the heretical matter of the humans. Right. But it is not the same matter anymore. The second point, consciousness and life do not reflect in this change of molecules. So we are growing towards that. What is a human being? In all what I have read, I see more and more how important it is to determine what is a human being. They have no notion of it. Because a human being is a body. Right. And it thinks. Right. They have never been able to connect the two. The mind-body problem. But what a human being actually is, how it feels, how it thinks, how it communicates, how it speaks, how it even walks, there is no idea. And there is such a confusion because all philosophers and all biologists and all scientists are giving different interpretations. So then you have this interpretation to rely on, which we have here again. Matter, vital, mind, spirit, the soul behind, and then the environmental consciousness called by some the aura through which we communicate, and so on. Sri Aurobindo writes somewhere, all the time the universal forces are pouring into the human being without it knowing it. The universal forces, all the time. He is aware only of thoughts, feelings, etc. that rise to the surface, and these he takes for his own. Really, they come from outside in mind waves, vital waves, waves of feeling and sensation, etc., which take particular form in him and rise to the surface after they have got inside. If that is true, then we must be extremely complex and all the time in connection with things which we translate, which come up in our consciousness from all levels, which is the evolution in us, which is the chakras in us. The chakras in us represent the levels of evolution. And when you can make yourself evolve even in matter, then the chakras may open. In Savitri, Sri Aurobindo writes, and it is in fact he makes Narad say to the king who is the father of Savitri, earth is the chosen place of mightiest souls. Earth is the heroic spirit's battlefield. Thy servitudes on earth are greater, king, than all the glorious liberties of heaven. We are incarnated souls. Not one time incarnated souls. We have a series of incarnations behind us and very surely a series of incarnations ahead of us. Sri Aurobindo says, and I put that, of course, in contrast to the Copernican principle, this alone, and he means the realization of the divine, is man's real business in the world and the justification of his existence, without which he would be only an insect crawling among the ephemeral insects on a speck of surface, mud and water, which has managed to form itself among the appalling immensities of the physical universe. There they have it. You have it, the physical universe. There you have the speck of matter. But behind this is that meaning. This alone is man's real business, the realization of the divine. So I think I am at my time, which I have set an hour and a quarter. You see, the littleness, if you take it from one standpoint, the non-importance, the absurdity, in which some also find something worthy to be thought about, and on the other side, in the same circumstances, in the same factual framework, you have the greatness of what we really are and what we are becoming. Thank you very much for listening. I hope I have been clear enough and that it may have been of some importance. Namaskar. Varakam.